Now we're going to look at functions. You may be familiar with functions already from Visual Basic or JavaScript, but if you've never used a programming language, you've probably used a function in Excel. So if you've typed in something like equals sum, and then you've given a range of cells, and you've hit enter, you've been using a function. And Excel will go off and count up all the values in the range of cells and return you a value. That's what functions do, typically. You give them an input, and they calculate some sort of output along rules that you specify and return you with usually a number or a text or a date. So what they don't do is they don't run off and edit data. They don't delete rows of data. You give them an input and they calculate an output for you. You can see from the breadcrumb bar that we are at the top level of the SQL database. And we have functions, procedures, tables and views. And this time we're looking at functions. And the SQL database has three for us already defined. We're going to look at inventory held by customer. So I've just clicked on it there. And if we scroll down, there's a definition there. Now, we could have returned this definition programmatically in MySQL by saying show create function and then using the function name. But this is just as easy to do. And just a reminder that what follows is specific to MySQL. So I've just copied that and pasted it into Atom so that we can look at it a bit more easily. So first of all, we have a login data, root at localhost, which we can largely ignore. And then we have function and the function name, inventory held by customer. After inventory held by customer, we have brackets, p inventory ID, int, and int means integer. P inventory ID is a variable name. So what does it mean to have that in brackets after the name of the function? When we use this function in SQL, we're going to use it much like this. Select inventory held by customer, and then we're going to supply a number in the brackets, and that's the P inventory ID, and the number needs to be an integer. And then this line says returns int. So this function is expecting an integer as an input, and it's going to give us an integer as an output as well. That's the whole purpose. So let's get rid of that. You can see that we have begin and end declarations to this function. And after that, we have a variable declaration and then an exit handler at the top. Now, this might look a bit odd because we're declaring a variable using the declare statement. And we've just seen that we can use the set statement with an at sign to declare a variable, like so. So why are these two things different? They're both variables in MySQL, but they're different kinds. Where you see the set keyword followed by the at sign, you're using a user-defined variable. And these are sort of longer-lasting variables, if you like. And let me tell you a bit more about that. If you tried to reference the customer ID after the end keyword, MySQL wouldn't know what you were talking about. Where you have a variable name and the declare keyword with no at sign, you're using a local variable. And these cease to exist after the end keyword. If instead we wanted to make reference down here to the user-defined keyword, that would be fine. They're longer lasting. They exist outside of the begin and the end declarations. But in a function like this, it's nice and tidy to have those variables disappear after the end statement. So we don't need to use these sort of larger user-defined ones. We can use local variables. In our second declaration statement, it says declare exit handler for not found return null, which looks like really bad grammar. And what it's saying is if the query finds no rows at all, then return a null. So show on screen the word null. After that, we have what looks like a regular select statement, except that this one has an into keyword. And what it's saying is select the customer ID and pop it into a variable called the customer ID. The customer ID is what is going to be returned, as in shown on screen. And you can see that further down the query next to the end declaration. It says return the customer ID. So that is what we're going to see on screen. So what's this select statement doing? It says select the customer ID from the rental table where the return date is null, that is to say the DVD is still on loan, and the inventory ID matches the number that's been given in the parameters. So let's run this and make a bit more sense of what's going on. Now, I haven't just made that number up. I've had a look through the tables to try and work out a sensible inventory ID to use. So select inventory held by customer 2047, returns us 155. Let's have a quick look back at our query. We have supplied an inventory ID, that is to say, a piece of stock or DVD with the number 2047 in the database. And this query is returning us the customer ID of the person who still has that on loan. What if we tried a different number? And again, here's one I prepared earlier. I'm going to try 367. You can see we returned a null. So now that could be a couple of different things. It may be that there's no customer has ever hired DVD 367, or it may be that no customer has it currently on loan. So let's have a quick look at what's going on. Select everything from the rental table where the inventory ID is 367, and we get five rows. So this DVD has been rented before, but if we look, the return date is filled in every case, which means all of those DVDs have been returned. There's no outstanding item. And that's why we got the null when we ran our function. Our declare exit handler came into play. Now, on its own, this function is a little bit unhelpful. Knowing that customer 155 has a movie that's still on loan is not really human readable. But functions can be useful as part of a query, and that's really how they're used. So let's say you're chasing up on an item of stock and you want the email address for the customer who still has a movie on loan. Then we could say, select email from the customer table where inventory held by customer 2047 is customer ID and inventory held by customer 2047 is not null. So this time we're using our function in a query to get the email address of anybody who still has an item of stock on loan. And we know that that was customer 155. And there we have the email of the offending customer, as it were. This tells us two things at once then. The customer does indeed have the movie still in her possession, and there's the email address to contact her. Using a function here is a substitute, really, for a subquery or joining tables together. It can be a lot quicker. And for common queries, this is a way of storing them so that you and other people can use them easily.